The fourth phase is when we actually do the exercises. Prior to the fourth, we're still thinking about it. The fourth phase, we actually do them, and they have a profoundly helpful effect. I've been experiencing it the last 12 hours. I spent yesterday taping all these practices, all these exercises. And then I was working on this video I have on Vice of Ramana Maharshi, putting subtitles on it, and it's a laborious work. At some point I said, you know, let me listen. I'm going to put on some YouTube, find some videos on YouTube, some music. And I think it was House of Gold by George Jones and Melba Montgomery. I put that on, and I was playing that over and over. Then I put it on autoplay, so it just automatically goes to some next YouTube suggested song. I said, I don't want to keep going back and forth playing replay. So I'm working on these subtitles of this video from Ramana Maharshi, very dedicated. And I hear this song come on, and in the back I'm just sort of listening to it, not paying too much attention. And I say, you know what? That's a really good song. I don't know who it is. I never heard of this, you know, group before. So I said, who is that? So I finally finished the subtitles, and I went over to check it out. You know, what was this song? What was this song? And it's this group I've never heard of before. So I started listening to some of their other songs, and I came across this one song that was just fantastic. One of the best songs I have ever heard. This group is really, really, really tremendously blessed with capacity to produce really fine music. And I kept listening to that song and this music, and it's gospel music. And then I finally went to bed like two o'clock in the morning or something like that. And I was just like buzzing, you know, some way. And I laid down and I suddenly felt this shift happen. Just like that, I don't know. And I felt the oneness. I felt like everything was just one massive block entity, so to speak. There were no divisions. And I just stayed in this mood, stayed in this for quite some time throughout the whole night. And it was quite something, quite interesting. Yeah. It didn't carry me away or anything. It was just very interesting. I said, I like this. And this is different. This is a different state of mind, or what is this? It's the non-dual condition. So somehow I was triggered by that, the overall thing, doing the exercises, working on Ramana Maharshi's video, maybe seeing his pictures. I'm working on the subtitles, and then hearing this music. It's the singing cooks. I hope we walk the last mile together. I think that's the song. I hope we walk the last mile together. Now I interpret it as great theme song for the situation we're in here in the world right now. As I interpret it as the Holy Spirit, Jesus, truth, divinity, reality, the oneness, saying, it's time to walk together now. This last mile, phase five, or phase four, going into phase five, let's walk it together. And I said, yeah, let's do that. That's great. Now, the previous night, I had this horrible dream where I was going along a road, and we stopped and sort of looked down the countryside, and it seemed like there was like something really dynamic off the side of the road. And so I sort of looked off the side of the road, and suddenly I was gripped with this fear, and it was like this huge drop off, and it seemed to go downhill super fast, and it seemed to just keep going like some endless canyon, some endless deep, deep, dark gorge. And I said, whoa. And so we explored it a little bit, went a little closer, see where does it drop off significantly. And we kind of got stuck on this ledge that these huge waterfalls were right beneath us, were pouring out into this endless, dark gorge and just thunderous mist and darkness, and oh, it was just this, you know, the most scary thing. And there were some people, there were some ladies there who tried to make the place look like it was attractive and glamorous. And I said, I gotta leave this place. This is scary. And I started walking up the right side, and it was very difficult to move. My body like was paralyzed with fear almost. And these sirens, I call them, were trying to sing and talk and laugh and say, hey, you should stay here, you should stay here, which is right on the brink of falling into this endless gorge, hideous endless gorge of darkness. And I was able to finally get up back to the road. And then someone was there and said, hey, and they were clearing away these light branches. They were all sort of entangled. They were sitting on the ground there. And they lifted all these entangled branches off. And there was like a golf ball, the white golf ball. And someone said, there's your golf ball. I said, what? I thought I had lost it. And what, it's incredible. It's still there? He said, yeah, it's still there. I looked at it and it looked in perfect condition. And then I woke up. I said, wow. Very significant dream. Meaning I'm coming back to reality, to the one self, to spirit. That flexible, resilient golf ball that, boom, you know, you hit it and it just flies. And it keeps its shape, and it doesn't get old, doesn't age. It's the adventurousness. And this was like a severe misadventure into this delusional hallucination. And of course, the final step of the fifth, when you reach the fifth phase, is to realize there never was a gorge. It was a hallucination. It's all perfectly flat. I mean, there isn't any place to fall into. There's no gorge to fall into, but this is the final realization. So meanwhile, we're kind of overcoming the shock of the whole situation of returning and realizing we're whole. We're perfect. Everything is fine. We just have been on this misadventure. We're not quite yet awakened to the fact that it was all just a dream. That's fine. That will come. So there's really great profundity happening right now in my situation. And since we're all one, actually, we're all experiencing it at some level, what's going on. I say there's a big boost coming. And this song that I heard was like just a tremendous boost. It is really... you know, it's one of those situations where something is so good, it deserves not to be thrown into comparison. You know, there's certain singers and songs, various things, we say, you know what, let's just let it be what it is. Don't try to compare, well, he's better than that, they're better than this, and this is the best, and that is the best. No, it's in the realm that deserves to be free of comparisons. We give it that honor, you know, it's honored by just saying it just is what it is. Just is what it is. And it's a huge surprise because, you know, being a connoisseur of music, I thought I heard all the best music, and this was stuff that's been around for 20, 30 years, actually. This song may have been recorded back in 1984, 30 years. Great, great music recorded back in the 70s and 80s. Never heard of them, and most people have never heard of them, I'm sure. It's just because they're like dedicated Christian gospel singers that just, you know, there's just like no ego there. They're just, it's amazing. They don't care about marketing themselves, anything. But they're just a family that just sings a tremendous, tremendous music. And so I said, wow, even when you're getting on in years, you can stumble across something that just kind of gives you a little boost. So these exercises, they work. They work. That's why people don't use them. If you want to know what the fourth stage is all about, that's about all the stuff that works. And the reason why people don't get there is they don't want, they want to hold on to attractive forms of failure. And the world is all struggling and competing for who can find the most attractive forms of failure. And this is given high marks. But when we actually practice this non-dual exercises, and I can't even remember what they are at this moment, which is okay. You don't need to struggle with that. It's effective. It's very effective. But in a subtle way, in a subtle way. See, this, the spirit is very subtle. There's not some brutal sort of shifts or changes. No, it's just like in an instant, just an instant that is an almost imperceptible instant. You just say, wow, I have sort of a different perspective. So we're in the last mile. We're in the last mile now of this end of the age situation here, which is opportunity for us. It is the greatest, most positive opportunity for us. So we don't want to look at it in a negative light at all. Not at all. The pressure that we're under is actually a good thing. It's basically demanding that we get the job done, actually do the exercises, actually do some practices, is demanding it of us, which is a great thing. Probably why we're here. Probably why we're here. We decided, you know what, let's be finished with this, with duality. And so what better place to come in than this world now, where there's this ferocious demand that we all be dualistic forever. And then we feel that, and it's so terrible, we say, no, no way. It's either this or that. We're going to get away from that deep, dark gorge. It's a hallucination, but it's a scary hallucination. Like you could easily just slip off into oblivion and never be heard from again, into just this endless depth of darkness. And that's a scary dream. So I'm sort of recovering my nerves, recovering, you know, from that ordeal. I saw the Godfather, and I didn't know what to do. I just said, okay, great, it's there. And I didn't know what to do next. I just said, you need a little time to just, you know, take a few deep breaths and let that terrible dream, you know, dissipate and vanish. So the trick now, the key, is positivity, positivity, positivity. The fourth stage, you're realizing you're safe, you're free. The bad dream is over. The bad dream is over. So I abided in this sort of a soft non-dual condition, just sort of back and forth with the world, as if I was dialoguing with the world to see what the world would say. And the world, of course, tried to pull me into words, into a certain position, and I kept resisting that, resisting it, resisting it. I said, relax into non-explanation. Relax into the totality of non-explanation. Of course, the thing is that what I found was the world is, there's supposedly a huge event. The future always seems to be extremely promising for dualism. Where else can you put the promise? They have to overlook the now, don't they? So it's always that way. There always seems to be some extremely promising development taking place, right, in so-called time. And space. And so they feel that if they relaxed into non-explanation, into the now, they would miss out on that. And so they're very adamant that they can't miss out on this, and that in fact they want you to make sure you don't miss out on it also. So they're very evangelical in terms of making sure you don't miss out on the future, on time, the developments. So they want to pull you back into delusion. This is the tug of war. This is the tug of war. And so I'm just engaged in this tug of war. Always have been my whole life, but now it's a little more conscious, a little more intense, and has to be resolved here. What they're really doing is they're trying to believe in their own future. And of course, you don't believe in future. There's only a totality each moment. There is no future. Totality doesn't have a future. It never gets outside of itself at all. It never gets ahead of itself. It never gets behind itself. And they feel that their identity, you need a future to form their identity. It's all this fear, all this fear. So, hopefully, there will be those that will be able to encourage us to actually do the exercises because they work. They actually work. They really evaporate the resistance. Because it's really practicing going beyond words. Give up all. That's what give up all words and give up all wordlessness. Abandon all words and all wordlessness and relax into I am. Abandon all words. Give up all words. Give up all wordlessness. Abandon all words and all wordlessness and relax into I am. The mother-child identity is a scam. Time is a scam. Space is a scam. Process is a scam. All that is a falsity. It's a stance of hallucination. I see how these identities have been playing this body. And that's not I am. It's not I am. It's I will be, but not I am. I am is the only identity there is. We could say, give up all I am not, and all I, give up all I will be, and all I am. Abandon all I will be, and all I am, and relax into I am. As you see, we have to transcend the idea that we're on a level of words. I am is not on the level of words. Never will be. It's not on the level of symbols. It cannot be symbolized because it's everything. Right now. There's no meaningful symbol for that. It cannot have any, it's meaningless to symbolize. To what would you symbolize it to? For what purpose? There's no purpose, there's no one to symbolize it to. It's all is. I am right now. So we have to practice getting past this relativity of words fundamentally in our being. And then words are only used from the standpoint of advice. Not trying to describe or explain, but just advise and encourage. Just advice and encouragement, that's all. We must relax and relax into non-explanation. Relax into non-explanation. Give up I will be, give up I am, abandon I will be and I am, and relax into non-explanation. So, non-explanation means oneness. There's nothing that needs explanation. There's nothing about reality that needs explanation. That's very important. Do you hear that? Those who ask for explanation are assuming that there will be there's someone who needs explanation. They don't, but there must be some need. So eventually there will be. No, there's nothing outside of totality, so that there's nothing that needs explanation. This is the realization. There's nothing that needs explanation. This is the great good news. You see that there's nothing separated from the oneness at all. There's nothing that needs explanation, therefore. How to get back home? Why did I separate? What is this condition of separate? What is the identity of separation? There's no need for any explanation, because that doesn't exist. We've just been hallucinating that there's separation, fragmentation. There isn't any. Why did we hallucinate? A whim. Just a whim. Why are we having such trouble? Well, when we hallucinate, we think that we're dependent upon the hallucinations, that we think we stop or we'll cease to exist. And all we also have this continuity fear, thinking that we need explanation. And suddenly we realize we don't need any, no explanation is needed. Everything's perfect. All is perfect. And we think, like, well, how can I, function? Where's my identity? How can I talk? How can I? And so we have this continuity fear. Of course, we're imagining it's a lot worse than it really is. It's probably not, bad at all. But we have this great fear that will be too shocked by it all. So I have to go carefully and gradually. Oneness does not require any explanation. There's no demands or needs whatsoever. So just relax into beyond explanation. Relax into beyond explanation. No need for explanation. So when people are frightened, they try to pressure you, say, well, there must be some need for explanation. So please explain to me. And all they're trying to do is get this feeling from you that you do need to explain. They say, well, you need to explain to me. And so I really need it. And so they want to get this feeling, which reinforces their fear. Like, oh, I see, we really are separate. There really is fragmentation. And that just reinforces the continuity fear, saying, okay, failure is the right thing to do. So they want to feel there's this need to explain. That's why Ramana Maharshi was just silent most of the time. There is no need to explain. The dewdrop, what happens to the dewdrop? It evaporates right into, it's no longer a form, is it, the dewdrop? The dewdrop, it evaporates. So the idea that our continuity fear, it just evaporates. Dewdrop is just an expression of our continuity fear. We say, hey, maybe this makes me feel safe, I want this appearance, and then when we gradually evaporate the continuity fear, no more dewdrop. It's like saying that if we see a rope as a snake and then we realize it's a rope, we say, well, what happened to the snake? It was never there. It was never there. The dewdrop was just an expression, temporary, just an appearance scene. Not a thing, not a form, actually. A chance precipitation. Anyway, it is the practicing which really brings about the... And you won't even notice. You do the practice, you say, and nothing happened, nothing happened. It's deeper and subtler than that. Now, the reason like the guru system was, people would go to the guru and they say, and the guru would give them a practice. That's the whole point of it. So you don't go to a guru until you're ready to do the practice. There's no use. Because the guru will say, do this practice, just this, do this, do this. That's what Nisargadatta Maharaj did, he said, I need a guru. I suddenly felt I need a guru. So a friend told him, hey, I go to see this guru, you should go see him. He went and saw the guru says, do this. He went home and just started doing it. And I don't even know if he even went back to see the guru. I may have not even gone back to see the guru just once or something. Maybe they saw him again, I don't know. But I think it was only once. And just did what the practice, and then relaxed into non-duality beyond explanation. Relaxed into no need for explanation. Just did the practice, that's all he did. Because he realized, this is going to work. I know this, he said, this is going to work, I know it. So he just did it. Day and night, day and night, day and night. He was just practicing, practicing, practicing. And it just, he said it just like dawned. The egg cracked on its own, just dawned. And there, just like that, it just worked. People wonder, well, how come I can't find a guru? Well, because we're not willing to do what the guru says to practice. You know, practice this, and we say, no, I want to think about it. No, why would this work? I want to figure out, how does this work? Our mind keeps thinking, like, I need to know exactly the cause and effect, and why is this being effective, and all this kind of stuff. it's evaporation. Why is evaporation effective? Well, we already know. What seems to be a solid form is not. It's just some density. And so you just decrease the density of it, and it goes into a formless, more formless condition. You just apply heat. You just apply that which is non-dense to the density, and it evaporates. So it's a matter of familiarity. What we're comfortable with, our attention. Where do we place our attention? It's just practicing placing our attention. That's why it works. What we put our attention on, we think that's what we are. So when we put our attention on beyond words, drop this, drop all stances, actually. These practices is bringing these stances to light. So you drop this stance and drop this stance. Drop this. Give up all problems, give up all resolutions. Give up all problems, give up all resolutions. Abandon all problems and resolutions and relax into no explanation. No explanation needed. Relax into no explanation needed. Relax into no explanation needed. Give up all problems, give up all solutions. These are stances that we take. But we don't need any stances, because there, in the oneness, there's no stance to take, actually. And there's no collapse that can happen either. There's nowhere to collapse to. Only concepts and words and stances can collapse. So what we're doing is practicing relinquishing them purposefully. Relinquish this attitude, this stance, and relax into beyond explanation. Relax into no explanation needed. Now, our intellect is that which takes stances. So our intellect will say, I don't understand, how can I take a stance? We don't need any stances. So let's walk the last mile together here. See, this is what we need to do in this world. Walk the last mile together. And together does mean actually practicing. And I haven't experienced anything bad from the practicing. The bad rap that spirituality has gotten is by those who have used stimulants and drugs and try to force things. That's the ego. That's the ego. The ego's trying to take a stance, a non-dual stance, you see. That's not it. So I say give up duality, give up all duality, give up all non-duality. Abandon all duality and non-duality and relax into no explanation needed. Just relax into no explanation needed. So of course the ego is going to give everything it does, it gives a bad name to it. But we have to brush this aside as ridiculous and do it the right way. Give up all conflict and give up all peace. Those are both stances. Abandon all conflict and all peace and relax into no explanation needed. Relax into the oneness. No explanation needed. So, the problem is, when you reach this fourth stage, if you keep trying to use your intellect to find a stance on it, we will stagnate. And then, you don't want it to stagnate. It will be problematical, for sure. So the spiritual path, you have to take it to the end. If you stop and stagnate, then you're going to have a very problematical outcomes, very problematical, really, because you'll try to take some super stance, and that's not it. Your mind will start working on what super stance can I take. So we have to practice at some point. Give up all ignorance, give up all wisdom, abandon all ignorance and all wisdom, and relax into the vision of oneness that needs no explanation. So, of course, I'm shifting into encouraging more practicing. If we don't do that, there's a world of trouble, actually, a world of trouble when you try to take some super stance. You're asking for a world of trouble. And some have done that. Some have stalled out. So I just encourage everyone to actually do the exercise. Don't stall out. And it may seem silly, like, oh, well, this is not doing anything. Well, yes, it is. Because you're getting comfortable of dropping stances, dropping all stances, all posing, all stances, conceptual, verbal, word, idea, thought, all these stances. Just drop them, drop. Give up all stances and all non-stances and relax into the vision of oneness. Give up all stances and all non-stances, abandon all stances and all non-stances, and relax into the vision of oneness. say this. I can feel this. This is, you feel the burn right now. Really feel it. So the ego will be saying, well, yeah, but how are you going to get a super stance? Wow, from that, you don't need a super stance. Just relax in the vision of oneness that needs no explanation. So this really puts the burn on the entire false construct. It really evaporates it. So we might hear some beautiful music, which is fine, it can give us a boost, but we cannot neglect actually practicing. We can say, give up all practice and all non-practice, give up all non-practice. Abandon all practice and all non-practice, and relax into the vision of oneness. Relax into the one being. Relax into the oneness of being. Relax into the oneness of being. Relax into the oneness of being. Give up all here. Give up all there. Abandon all here and there. And relax into the oneness of being that needs no explanation. I would say the problematical nature of the situation in this world is simply that people don't do the right practice, don't practice enough. Their heads are turned too much towards pseudo-intellectualism, drugs, all sorts of things that make them seemingly feel good. They don't actually apply themselves. The pseudo-intellectualism gets in the way. The world is full of pseudo-intellectuals. It's being run by pseudo-intellectuals, not real intellectuals. Real intellectuals are not stupid. They get to practicing, they get it. A real intellectual is very smart. It's the pseudo-intellectuals that the universities and our educational system is churning out. They're churning out pseudo-intellectuals. These people they're the blind leading the blind. They only have been taught how to act as if they could see. But they really can't see at all. They're pseudo-intellectuals. Just President of the United States, pseudo-intellectual, very much so. And leading the country and the world astray by others who idolize pseudo-intellectualism, thinking that that's seeing, there's a way around doing the exercises, there's a way around the spiritual path. Well, pretend. Will be pseudo-intellectuals. Very bad. Very bad. So you it should be a gut punch. You should feel a gut punch from this. That's what gut punches are okay certain times. You realize, we've been paying too much attention to pseudo-intellectuals, which is very true. We have. All the media, all the people in the media, they're pseudo-intellectuals. People write all these books, sociological books, they're pseudo-intellectuals. Okay. Even therapists are pseudo-intellectuals. This whole educational system that we've had came from what? From Prussia, and developed the way that it is now. Aristotelian, Lockean. It's pseudo-intellectualism. This produces these posers. And then this is very bad outcomes, very bad, because they end up developing these super stances, rigid stances, and collapses happen, all sorts of stuff that you don't want. So just let this gut punch, feel the gut punch, that's fine. We don't have to walk hand in hand with the pseudo-intellectuals anymore. With the guru, walk with right practice, walk with the oneness, walk with the totality, walk with the oneness of being, walk with that which is beyond the need of any explanation. Walk with your own, what would you say, capacity. And just, wear the gut punch. You have to don't disassociate from it. It's kind of that, the wake-up call. It's like the alarm clock. You know, let the alarm clock keep ringing. Maybe hit it on snooze, but don't turn it off. Hit it on snooze, and then, it rings again. Hit it on snooze, again. You know, hit it on snooze. And gradually it wakes you up. This is the mood of repentance is the one who hits the snooze button. The others, they turn the alarm clock off altogether, and they go back to sleep. So just keep hitting the snooze bar. And try to keep waking up. Try to keep waking up. You will. You will. Hit the snooze. Practice some more. Practice some more. Practice some more. And then you'll feel this gut punch at some point. Like, wow. I need to wake up. I need to get up. And then you just kind of get groggy again. Truth is like an alarm clock. And so we all need to have that alarm clock keep ringing, ringing, ringing. Hearing that music was an alarm clock gut punch because you could just hear how absolutely different that music is than the music now. And you just say, wow. It to me, it sounds authentic compared to now. This music is like pseudo. It's from a stance of pseudo-intellectualism. That we're following a pseudo path, this fake pseudo path, and the music reflects the culture. But this music, it reflects this authenticity. Now these people really believe in Glory Land, and you know they do. Now. They don't have it all smoothed out, okay, the first phase, but they really believe. They know, you know, it's in their bones. I mean, they're this authentically, like, I know that salvation exists. They know it. And so the music expresses that they realize this world here is has no value for them. And they're going to a place that has true value for them. And it's not an intellectual position at all. It's a gut, you know, in the bones, total, like, knowing position. Now, a lot of it has to do with wanting to continue family ties and all that. So it's not the you know, final resolution by any means. But just hearing authenticity, you can hear it and say, wow. That is so different than what we have now. You know, the difference is they say, I finally escaped this awful place. I crossed the River Jordan. I flew away. I'm now with Jesus, and he's so happy to see me. Everything's great. But they don't realize that they never left heaven. There isn't any place other than heaven. There is no leaving. It was all a dream. It's all hallucination. So that's, see, it's still dualistic. Like, okay, there's hell here, and we got to heaven. Okay. That's phase one ideology. It's still dualistic. And yet it's allowing the idea of escaping this dream to, you know, to permeate gradually. The ultimate escape is realize there isn't anything to escape from. What we thought, what we were hallucinating, isn't there. And so there's no threat at all. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. This is Jesus, as he says, a summation of all teaching. Nothing real can be threatened. nothing unreal exists. And it's not about family ties, it's about the oneness. This oneness transcends family ties. Now, in this culture of the Christian gospel music, that's very much into family ties, and they say, you know, their hope is that when they die, they'll meet the ones that have gone died before, their mom, their dad, their brothers, their sisters, you know, whoever else has died that they really had an affection, attachment for. They'll be there in heaven waiting for them, okay? And that's their hope, that these, you know, getting separated here on in this world will be reunited forever, that kind of stuff. Now, obviously, that is not the ultimate resolution of the situation. So it's kind of a blend. It's a phase one. It's phase one. Okay. But in phase one, there's some authenticity there. In phase one, there is. And it's nice to experience that in this extremely inauthentic world right now, this pseudo world. So the practices take us beyond this pseudo-ness, and we realize, wow, all stances are not needed. There are no stances that are needed whatsoever. There are no stances in reality, in oneness, in being. And yet, these practices cannot be successful merely through intellectually thinking about them. That's a stance. It's saying, okay, what kind of stance can I have in relation to these practices? By doing the practice, immersing yourself in it, and then feeling this burn of no stance, this is where it's at. This is what works. Continue to urge this, and there's these exercises there, phase four exercises. I'll put a playlist up, and just try to do them. Immerse yourself in it. Immerse yourself in this no stanceness, and feel the burn. Just feel the burn. Did you expect it? Of course. It's the strain, the burn. Welcome it. Say, oh, it's great. It's an alarm clock. Give up all stances and all non. Give up all stances. Give up all non-stances. Abandon all stances and all non-stances and relax into the oneness of being. Relax into the total oneness of being. Or we could say, and relax into that which cannot be talked about. Relax into that which cannot be talked about. Relax into that which cannot be explained. Relax into that which is beyond explanation. Relax into that. See, there's no words, is there? Relax into that. So they say that. We just relax into that. Give up all explanations, give up all non-explanations. Abandon all explanations and all non-explanations and relax into that. And there's this burn of it, indignant and consternation. Just say, great, just don't judge it, just sit here quietly with it. We because the intellect insists that it can explain everything, take a stance on everything, and we're just saying relax into that. And the ego says, into what? Into what? Where's the stance? And no, just into that. Give up all clarity. Give up all confusion. Abandon all clarity and all confusion and relax into that. See, this is so, in a matter of just doing this over and over every day and welcoming this indignity and consternation and this burn, full stop in the burn, and that wears it away. It simply wears it away. That's what Sri Sri Nandamayama said, and who's the master of practices, suggesting practices and saying you must do it, saying you simply have to wear it away. There's no other way. Wear it away. Wear it away. Wear it away. Just wear it away. Gradually wear it away. And then one day she said, it just won't be there anymore. It's worn away. So that's why the teachers will tell you, get after it. Get after it. Get after it. Because it's a wearing away process of this feeling of indignity. It's the intellectual posturing, which is just like saying, wow, 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 wait, what are you doing? What is this, some kind of trick? Why, you know, it's just like full of consternation. Now the world is going to pull it, the posers will pull a tricky thing, in which the pseudo-enlightenment, so to speak, where it will shift and change things in the world so much that people think, oh, haha, this is causing me consternation and indignity, but this is good because for me, you know, that's all pseudo, that's not spiritual practice. It's designed to give you like a sense of that you're on a pseudo spiritual path, not doing it at all, still totally within dualism. So people are waiting for that, thinking that, oh yeah, the master is coming, the teacher, the world's going to teach us a big lesson and all this. Now, you cannot do it that way. And just hearing you cannot do it that way, that causes consternation and indignity too, so just stay with that burn. All they're doing is adopting new stances. See, that's not it. Sure, they might be tearing down a lot of stances, but at the same time, they're adopting all stances. So I say, give up all tearing down. Give up all building up. Abandon all tearing down and all building up and relax into that. Give up all collapses. Give up all non-collapses. Abandon all collapses and all non-collapses and relax into that. Whatever you do, don't struggle. Full stop on the now. Don't try to make it stronger. That's a trick. When you're trying to make it stronger, it means it's already super strong for you, and you're trying to actually escape it, but very cleverly claim you're trying to make it more intense. Intensity is already very strong. We know that what's coming in the future doesn't work, and yet it's a great pseudo excuse, you know, say, oh no, we're doing what we need to do. It's the form, you know, trying to do the form, but not the content is not there. So it doesn't work. Abandon what doesn't work, and abandon what does work. Give up what doesn't work, and give up what does work. Abandon all what doesn't work, and all what does work. And relax into that. Abandon all pseudo-ness, give up all pseudo-ness, and give up all non-pseudo-ness. Give up all pseudo-ness, and give up all genuineness. Abandon all pseudo-ness and all genuineness, and relax into that. Don't try to make it more intense. This is very intense right now. Give up all hope, give up all despair. Abandon all hope and abandon all despair and relax into that. Do not calculate the effectiveness, do not measure it. Do not try to make it more or less. Full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. This is just simple, simple. That's all you need to know. In any spiritual practice, is full stop in the burn. That's it. Full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. Works with all practices. See? So it's very simple. Practices, see, we don't want to do them. We think they're all complicated. Like, can you explain this? No, it's just very simple. There will be this indignity, consternation, burn, and you just don't, just full stop right there. Don't struggle. Don't try to make it more or less. Just get used to it. Because the consternation and indignity is saying, hey, you just moved my position. Or, I can't find my position right now. I say, that's okay. Mind is just like saying, well, what's my position? What's my position? Don't try to answer that question. Don't answer. No dialogue. Full stop means no dialogue. You're not answering any questions. You're not giving any explanations. Just full stop. No explanations. No dialogue. give up all I can't do it and all I can do it and relax into that. See, all the positive stances we have are really just the way that the negative is hiding itself. So, the saying, yeah, I can do it, the stance, I can do it. It's really the stance is saying, I can't do it, but I'm going to pseudo fake it and say, take the stance that I can do it. I can't do it, it's just a stance. It's not doing it, it's a stance. I can do it. We're not worried about stances. We're only concerned about actually doing it. Actually relaxing into that. That's not a stance. Relaxing into that is not a stance. And we can even say, give up all relaxing into that, and give up all non-relaxing into that. Abandon all relaxing into that, and all non-relaxing into that, and relax into that. So I hope we walk the last mile together. It's easy. It's easy. It's just like shaking off the cobwebs, that's all. See, it's not about doing something really difficult all at once. It's about, bit by bit, gradually, just keep shifting this comfort zone. So the consternation gets less and less. The indignity gets less and less. Until it's just a mere trifle, really. Give up all investing. Give up all divesting. Abandon all investing and all divesting and relax into that. See, fourth phase works at the very root of it. The earlier phases, people want results, like, you know, physical results. They do yoga and various things, and breathing exercises. They want, you know, emotional stuff. They want results they can measure, they can feel. This here is working at the total sum total of all resistance. The sum total of it. So we're not trying to calculate, judge, look for results. This is evaporating the whole entire complex all at once. The whole thing is evaporating. So it's very deep. It's seemingly subtle to us because the whole complex is being evaporated. Give up all results and give up all non-results. Abandon all results and all non-results and relax into that. So these are like wind sprints. You do a wind sprint, you rest for a little while. You just... The pseudo-intellectuals, they pretend they know better. They know best. They have to, they can maintain their posturing, right? They can't admit that they don't know best. They think they know better than everyone. And so they will tell everybody else, yeah, this is what you need to do, this is what you need to do. I mean, I've run into this a lot, pseudo-intellectuals. They tell you with great certainty and authority, yes, this is it. It's an act. And I found that then doing what the pseudo-intellectuals say, I just test it out, and it turns out they're completely wrong. But they're very good at pretending to be absolutely certain. It's an act. It's an act. They don't know what they're doing. They're very much mistaken. In fact, their whole goal is to fail. They're hiding that goal behind the pseudo-certainty of success. But their real goal is to fail. And that's why people are following them, because they can see, this is going to fail. But it's pretending to be a success. So we feel like this is how we feel the safest. We don't want to recognize that we're trying to fail. Because then we'll say, hey, wait a minute. Why am I trying to fail? What am I trying to fail at? So what we try to do is we try to pretend to be succeeding while we're really invested in succeeding. So give up all success and give up all failure. Abandon all success and all failure and relax into that. So the fourth phase is the hammer phase. I call Jesus the hammer because he suggests, you know, doing these exercises. This is very important. And so it feels like something got hammered. You're not really sure what. But just like, whoa, something just got hammered there. Wow. The whole house is shaking. Like, boom. Like, you know, someone brings a sledgehammer somewhere in a house you're constructing. You know, boom. Boom, and the whole house was reverberating, shaking. People say, wow, where's that coming from? I'm not really sure. It could be something in the attic. Who knows where it's coming from? But the whole house is feeling it. The whole house is shaking. It's like, oh, wow, someone's really going to work up there. So just give up all success and give up all failure and abandon all success and all failure and relax into that. Again, don't be concerned about how many words you use. is the potency that matters. The pseudo-intellect might say, well, I need to do, you know, 10 times, 100 words. They're counting, they're measuring, you know, all this. No, we're not putting any limit one way or the other. Give up all limits and give up all non-limits. Give up limitation, give up non-limitation, give up limits, give up unlimitedness. Give up all limitations, give up all spontaneity. Abandon all limitations and abandon all spontaneity and relax into that. See, this game of duality is a game. It's fear-based. The good is only hiding the fear. All the good posturing is only hiding the fear. It's how we successfully hold on to the fear. Because we're not seeing the fear as what it really is. We're focusing on, well, I have a successful posture here, or, you know, the positive postures. Abandon both. Abandon all negative. Give up all negative. Give up all positive. Give up all negative. Give up all positive. Give up all negative stances. Give up all positive stances. Abandon all negative stances and abandon all positive stances and relax into that. So there is this mild freak out going on in your overall complex is just saying, wow. Kind of stunned, like, wow. That's fine. Just really full stop with that. Because we really don't have an intellectual position, do we? We're practicing going beyond all positioning. All positioning. There's no position in that, in oneness. None. There's just a oneness. Imagine the relief you will feel when you don't need to take any position at all. All this positive positioning and posturing we're doing is rest on a negative foundation of fear. It's all a distraction device. So give up both. You say, give up both. And we're not falling in the dualistic trap. The ego said, wait a minute, you're giving up the positive. Well, then you're that means you want the negative. No, we're saying give up both simultaneously. Abandon all positive and abandon all negative and relax into that. So these exercises knock out the ego's objections. It just, you know, they're no longer in play. And then we realize, wow, these ego defenses don't work anymore. And so we're really feeling this is the end of egoic defenses. They don't work anymore. And just getting used to that. Ego defenses are like a horse that we're used to riding, a crazy wild horse. I remember the dream I had where I changed horses from one that was just impossible to control to a horse that was absolutely calm and still, perfectly, immaculately behaved in attitude. And I rode that new horse, and it was like fantastic. So this is just change horses. Fourth stage is about changing horses, changing vehicles. We've already gotten off the horse in the first, second, third phases. We finally dismount from this horse, this crazy horse. But now we're thinking, what do I ride? And here's this new horse just appears. And you say, wow. And we just get on this horse. And there's no need to control it. It's perfectly controlled. It controls itself. It's non-dual. The horse is just amazing. You say, oh, this is incredible. Cannot throw me, cannot veer off. It does not have a will of its own. It's not trying to, you know. It's like one. It's just oneness. The horse of oneness. It's easy. You're going to be uncomfortable anyway during the day, right? Most days you'll feel uncomfortable in some way. You might as well consciously do something that makes you uncomfortable, that you know is freeing you from all discomfort. That's being smart. That will truly do so. Throw out duality simultaneously. All duality goes simultaneously. Coincided. Two sides of one coin, both go. Throw the coin away, both go, positive and the negative. All stances. Reality doesn't need any stance. There's nothing to take a stance against, for or against. Give up all stances for, give up all stances against. Abandon all stances for, abandon all stances against, and relax into that. Give up all pro, give up all con, abandon all pro and con, and relax into that. All right, very great. We could keep going, but this is powerful, and just, we will continue to keep going, but we'll take a little break now. All right, that's it.